see that I actually put a title on my sermon for the once, and then I realize I'm not even preaching about taxes this week. So this is why I usually don't put titles on my sermons, because they usually change between the time I write it on Wednesday and by the time I come about to preaching it on Sunday. I should learn. So anyway, here is our gospel lesson for the day. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor and the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. So that's actually my title, "Whose Image?" You can see. Jesus has finally arrived, like that high school prodigy that you knew that went to Carnegie Hall, right? Jesus made it to Jerusalem. He had been preaching in the hinterlands. He had been doing miracles to all the rural folks. And now he finally comes into Jerusalem. Now, in one scripture, he's on top of a donkey. In another one, he's on a horse. In another one, he's on a donkey and a horse. Don't tell me how he could be riding both at the same time. But we know that Jesus comes into the city of Jerusalem, the great fanfare. People lay down their palm branches and their cloaks down on the ground to welcome him as their king. Jesus goes immediately to the temple, and the first thing he does is he gets himself into a little trouble, right? If you remember Matthew, he clears out the temple of all the money changers. Well, there's a reason for that. If you think about the time and what was important for the religion in that time, Judaism, you were supposed to offer your sacrifices to God at the high holy temple. Well, the only sacrifices that were permissible were things that were tangible, like doves or goats or calves. And so what would happen is if you were coming 70 miles, 80 miles, 90 miles away from Jerusalem, well, you really couldn't bring that calf with you on the road because it wouldn't be in any good shape for it to be acceptable to the priests in the temple. And so when you arrive to the temple, what you would do is you would take your money and you would purchase a dove. Money changers basically would give you an exchange rate, kind of like when you go to the airport and you have to pay 10% change. Anybody ever have to change money into a different currency and how much money you end up losing, and then you have all that change you can never use again because it's all coins? Yeah. Same thing here. They would come from their places and they would use whatever money they had available to buy the doves, to buy the calves, to buy the stuff like that, and they would then use those sacrifices to fulfill their role. So Jesus got himself into some trouble because he went in and said, "You hypocrites, why are you allowing yourselves to do this? Why are you manipulating the currency? Why are you taking advantage of the poor who are just trying to worship God?" So it's after that event that Jesus is confronted in the temple by a group of Pharisees and by a group of Herodians. Now, these two factions don't like each other. The Herodians are your political establishment. They're the ones that support the Roman occupation of Jerusalem. The Pharisees, on the other hand, are the religious leaders who are totally against the religious occupation, and yet both of them have come to talk to Jesus. And as we hear from our scripture today, they have come to trap Jesus. Now, Jesus is able to escape that trap, and he's very wise in how he does that. First of all, he asks for a Roman coin. He asks for, well, what is the coin that you pay in the taxes? And of course, the Romans aren't going to accept your Jewish money. They're going to accept only the denarius. And so again, you have all these taxes that have to be paid by the people. And what did that tax go for? Well, it paid for the Romans to actually occupy your territory. So you don't want the Romans there in the first place, and then you have to pay them to be there. How would y'all feel if someone decided to come into your house and take up a room, and you weren't allowed to say no to them, and then you had to pay them for the privilege of being there? That make you angry too? So you can see this is a political and religious conflict that's going on in Jesus' time. So Jesus, in the first place, they're in the temple. He asks for the Roman coin. You know, he doesn't have one on himself. He borrows it. So that's the first way that he overcomes their test. He says, "You hypocrites, you guys have a Roman coin on you, and I'm borrowing it from you. And tell me whose face is on it." See, Jesus reminds them in that act of borrowing that coin from them that they've already made their choice. The Herodians and the Pharisees, by participating in the economic structure of the Romans, by using the denarius to, you know, pay for the sacrifices at the temple, by using the denarius in their everyday lives, they are already acquiescing to what the Roman occupiers are doing. And so that's one way that Jesus escapes that trap. And then he asks, well, whose image is it? And what does it say underneath that image? Well, as you can see, this is a picture of one of those denariuses back in that time, and we've got a couple of different examples. And the images on there are of Caesar, Augustus Caesar. And the Greek lettering or the Latin lettering that's on there stands for Son of God. So here you have this man who puts on his money, "I am God, here's my money, use it." Right? And so what Jesus says to those Pharisees and to the Herodians is, well, whose image is on it? Well, it's the emperor's. Well, if it's the emperor's money and he has his image on it and he thinks he's God, well, let's give him back what is his. Again, this is very clear. If you're using the money that the Romans have given you, then give back to them according to the laws they set for you. Well, the question that we're left with then is in the second part of that answer that Jesus gives. He says, give to the emperor's what is the emperor's, but give to God what is God's. And for the hearers back then, and for us, and for the religious leaders and the political leaders, well, they hear what Jesus says, and they say, well, what is God's? Well, and this is where Jesus, again, escapes their trap, because he is calling back to mind for all of us that first story of creation in Genesis, where God is telling us that we are going to create image creating humankind in our image. Male and female, we are going to create them. And so what we are told in the earliest part of Jewish scriptures is that we are made in the image of God, that we belong to God. So when Jesus answers, give to God what is God's, give to the emperor what is emperor's, what he's saying is that, well, all of us belong to God. So give of yourself, your life, your love, your mind, your heart, soul, things that we know are part of that greatest commandment. He says, this is what you are to give. Now, Jesus has not wavered from his teaching about the role of God in our lives and the role as God's people. We belong to God. We are made in God's image. We bear the image of God in our lives, in our hearts, and in our actions. And if we belong to God, then we give ourselves back to God. And for the people in Jesus' time, this is a message of hope. Like I said, we already talked about the economic slavery the Romans put them in under the taxes that were really high. But beyond that, there was also this feeling that you were responsible to so many other things. You know, people owed more than they could pay. Their lives were not their own. They worked for another person. They worked for another master, even if the slavery that they were in was not as striking as the slavery that we know in our own American history. And we know that slavery has been illegal in our country for 150 years, but there are still many who are enslaved in our country. And there, we know about sex trafficking and human trafficking for labor. You may know that there is organ trafficking even in our country. Recently, there's a nonprofit organization that says that 1.5 million people each year are trafficked in the United States. Now, we have a population of 342 million, so it's not like it's all, you know, it's less than 1%, but still 1.5 million people are enslaved in our country. The FBI this week conducted raids nationwide. They were able to rescue 84 children, one as young as 3 months old, from sex trafficking. They captured over 120 people who were part of that this week, and that was just one incident in 1 week. Now, those numbers don't seem to be overwhelming. But I was reading about sex trafficking and realized that women, more than men, are a part of that. 70% of young girls between the age of 11 and 14 are trafficked, are the victims of trafficking. sorry, 70% of the people who are victims, not 70% of women, but 70% of the victims of sex trafficking are 11 to 14-year-old girls. Now, the reality is we also have a different type of slavery in our country, and that's economic slavery. And I think many of us enter into that voluntarily. We don't realize that we're enslaved until about 10 or 20 years into our life, right? We start getting educational loans to go to college, and all of a sudden we have $100,000 in debt by the time we're 23. I want you to think about that for some of you who are older. How much was your first house or your first car? I used to joke that when I graduated from seminary, I owned my own first BMW, even though I don't have one, right? So we get our educational loans and we get the debt. And then maybe we get to a point where we live beyond our means for a little while and we find ourselves trapped in ever-increasing cycles of debt that lead us to working for the benefit of somebody else. There are people who feel trapped that they can never leave their jobs because they cannot pay the bills that they have left behind. And what about those who have a health emergency? All it takes is one emergency sometimes, to lose your job, to lose your insurance, and then to be trapped in medical debt. And then, what about those we know who are older, who live beyond their retirement accounts? And they lose all they have, including their houses, and are trapped by a facility that keeps them until they die. We see economic slavery all around us, but we accept it because we just think it's a part of life. And I think many of us in our country feel trapped. We feel as if we belong to somebody else. We feel as if our work is not ours. But here we have Jesus giving us a word of hope. Give to society what is owed them. But you know, in the end, all things belong to God. We belong to God. We bear the image of God. Don't get wrapped up in the politics of power. Don't get lost in the legalism of religious devotion. Jesus says this to both the Herodians and the Pharisees and to us. Jesus asks us today in our scripture to say, who do we belong to? We are God's. God made us. God loves us. God will take care of us. God will give us freedom even when we don't feel like we have any. And there's a theologian who recently wrote, she's studying African-American theology of the early 1800s, reading and studying the Gospels and the preaching that was done at that time. And she said that one of the things that came out over anything else during that time of slavery in the African-American church tradition was, well, you can own my body, but you don't own my soul. Now, Jesus said something very similar to that in Matthew chapter 10. He says, do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Truth is, we are the embodiment of God's promises in this world. We own our thoughts. We control how we respond and act to others. We control our emotional responses to others. Even when we feel trapped, whether it's economic slavery, whether it's physical slavery, we still have the capacity for reason. We have the capacity to believe. We have the capacity of having our hearts being still able to offer grace and love to others. We know that our bodies will one day die. We may have rough times ahead because of the choices we have made and the ones that we will make. But God is always renewing us. God is always creating us day by day in his most perfect image. And you know what? God promises a new life of freedom one day. So as you go out into the world today, don't get trapped by politics or division. Don't get trapped by your economics or by anything else. Instead, celebrate the gift of being made in God's image. And go out with joy and hope. Amen.
Amen.
We're very blessed today to have the Ambassadors of Joy who are coming to sing. I guess they're making their way now. David, I think, went another way.
So.
Well, Gary's getting everything set up. I just wanted to share a joy with you. My nephew, Josh Pritchett, graduated from boot camp.
Yay.
He's now in Georgia still, but he's at Camp Gordon, and he is studying, I don't know how to say all this.
It's actually Fort Gordon, I think.
Fort Gordon, not camp. He's not camping. Sorry. Yeah. He is studying...
Signal Corps?
Like, secret intelligence on computers.
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah. And his dad had been in the hospital in ICU in Winchester for a week and a half and was able to get out in time to go and see him graduate. So. So that's a big joy.
Valley.
He had to walk
it by himself. nobody else could walk it for him.
He had to walk
it by himself.
We must walk
this lonesome valley.
We had to walk
it by ourselves.
Nobody else
could walk it for us.
We had to walk
it by ourselves.
You must go
and stand your trial.
You have to stand
it by yourself.
Nobody else
can stand it for you.
You have to stand
it by yourself.
Jesus walked
this lonesome valley.
He had to walk
it by himself.
Nobody else
could walk it for you.
Go in peace. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.